In today's society, social media platforms have become a primary source of communication and self-expression. For many people, especially those who are considered to be social commentators, YouTube has become the preferred platform to express their opinions and engage with their audience. Kidology, a lefty social commentator, is one such person who has built a large following on YouTube. However, recently she found herself in a situation where she felt ostracized by other fellow lefty YouTube commentators.
After you, I thought that was really interesting because I'm like, oh, because I wanted to watch him for a while, but he's too progressive for me. Like, there's certain progressive voices I can't handle. It sounds the same as listening to a conservative. I just get like a headache because it's the same. It's just talking points. Like, I'm like, where is your opinion? Like, your real thought. So what did it feel like having somebody with an obviously a script go at you the way he did? And he had other buddies with him, didn't he?
Oh, yes. Yes.
So
yes.
You got piled on. How did that feel?
Oh, gosh. Yeah, that was a lot. I think for me, it wasn't the getting piled on in as much as I sort of came to the position. I made this video about the left and then they made a video response and that was fine. I was like, okay, you've done your thing. I've watched this. I can take that. The issue that I had was primarily with their attempt to psychoanalyze me and in the comment, this very fabricated psychoanalysis of me being self-hating, anti-black, a TERF because I live on TERF Island, just all these sort of things. And especially creators who I also watch in the comment section, like big creators saying, you know, used to watch her, don't anymore because she doesn't, she's not progressive enough or she's not this or that, or, you know, she's a TERF. And it's, that was very disappointing for me. I think insofar as I found myself, at least in my responses, being very willing to say, okay, I'm going to put myself aside for a second. I'm going to take myself out of my shoes and I'm going to put my feet into your shoes, into your world, into your reality. Even though those shoes don't fit me, they weren't made for me. They're not for my feet. I'm going to squeeze my feet in there and I'm just going to see everything from your perspective. I'm going to read what you read. I'm going to read your sources, your data, your... I'm going to see the world through your lens of reason, which is sort of belief presented as fact and truth. And for me, I think the thing that really affected me and sort of shook me after that was that they weren't willing to do the same thing. They weren't willing to take themselves out of their shoes.
Right.
And sort of put my shoes on. And I guess maybe it's naive that I sort of have this hope that that's what we'll be able to do, sort of at least when we talk to people, when we have conversations, when we disagree, that it is sort of, you know, you have your bias, you have your prejudice, you have your bubble, you have your projection of what reality is for you and therefore for everybody else. But at some point, when you talk to people, you're faced with another consciousness, another reality, another representation of the world. And in order to make it work, in order to sort of make something out of the chaos that is a completely different experience, confronting and challenging yours, like, you know, you've got to swap shoes, you've got to try on different shoes, you know, you've got to somehow make it work.
Yeah.
And I found that they weren't willing to do that. And that was what got to me. That sort of, and it was somehow all my fault that it wasn't happening, that the conversation and dialogue wasn't happening, because it wasn't a dialogue that was a dialogue of me saying, I accept that I'm this, that, and the other. I accept that, you know, you all know me better than I know myself. I definitely wanted to approach them from, I think, very much sort of my allegiance to the levels, that idea of sort of appreciating that we have different bubbles, different realities, but, like, you know, we can still talk, we can still learn from each other. And it's like, I want to learn from you. I will try my best to learn from you and what you see and how you see things. Please do the same for me. And that just wasn't there. That reciprocity that I really value and I think is so important to just being a human and sort of realizing, actually, none of us has the truth. None of us really knows. None of us is really as great and all-knowing as we like to think we are. None of our experiences and none of our individuality is really that important. Like, okay, you're a transgender person. You have your experiences. Okay, that's great. You know, I'm a Black woman. I have my experiences. Right. None of us is really shit. We're just people.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah.
So I think that was, for me, what frustrated me a lot, that unwillingness on their part. And also them not wanting to talk to me.
They don't want to talk to you at all? Like, did you reach out? Did they reach out? Or is there, like, did they say?
Yeah. Like, before this whole thing happened, like, FD Signifier, he emailed me, wanted to speak to me. I said, yes, let's do it. Then he didn't respond. I was like, okay, fine. Then this video happened a long time after, like a year after that. And I was like, okay, well, I want to talk to you. Okay. We sort of arranged to talk, but then he ignored me again. And I feel, and he's told me, like, he wrote this long email telling me not to speak to Destiny or to Vorsch or these, like, content farmers, all these people who are just going to try to make content out of me. He wants to talk to me in a safe space where we talk just privately and not sort of in front of an audience, not live, whatever. I don't know if things have changed now, but it just did not make sense to me, at least not in the way of, I think, politics. Firstly, politics, you have to talk to people you don't agree with. You have to speak to your enemies.
Yeah.
If you want to change the world and change reality and get everybody on board, you have to speak to everybody.
Yeah.
The people you don't agree with, whatever, you have to, like, face the music. So that makes no sense. There's no safe space in politics. I think there's only safe space in your private life and your private world.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't make sense to me, but I'd like to speak to him. But he's been quite aloof.
Isn't that so interesting? That's happened to me too, where, like,
Kidology recently released a video where she pointed out some ideological differences she might have with the rest of the left-leaning community. This video sparked a lot of debate and discussion, with one fellow male YouTuber, FD Signifier, even going so far as to do a multi-hour live stream breaking down her video with some other YouTubers. Kidology didn't like the way they attempted to pseudo-psychologically analyze her and felt that it was inappropriate. When Kidology reached out to FD Signifier to discuss the situation, he offered to have the discourse in a private setting, which Kidology did not agree with. She felt that as a fellow YouTuber, she deserves to speak to FD Signifier publicly, so that the audience would be aware of the discourse. However, when Kidology informed FD Signifier of her counteroffer, he stopped responding to her emails. The tendency of left-leaning commentators to engage in purity testing and create echo chambers is a growing concern in today's political landscape. Purity testing refers to the practice of evaluating someone's political views based on a strict set of criteria and dismissing those who do not conform to the same beliefs. This has resulted in the creation of echo chambers, where like-minded individuals only engage with and reinforce each other's opinions, creating a self-reinforcing cycle of ideology. One of the primary reasons for this tendency is the increasing polarization of political views, especially in the wake of the rise of social media. Social media algorithms have created echo chambers by showing people content that aligns with their beliefs, making it easier for individuals to only engage with ideas and opinions that they already agree with. This has led to a situation where individuals are increasingly surrounded by opinions that are similar to their own, leading to the reinforcement of their beliefs and a heightened sense of self-righteousness. The problem with this approach is that it stifles healthy debate and discourages diversity of thought. When individuals are only exposed to ideas that they already agree with, they are less likely to question their beliefs and less likely to consider alternative perspectives. This can result in a narrow-minded and rigid approach to politics that fails to take into account the complexities of the world. In addition, purity testing can also lead to the ostracization of individuals who do not conform to the same beliefs. This can result in a situation where individuals who hold different views are effectively silenced, as they are no longer welcomed in the political discourse. This can further reinforce the existing echo chambers, as individuals are less likely to engage with those who hold different views, creating a self-reinforcing cycle of ideology. In conclusion, the ostracization of Codology by other lefty YouTubers highlights the negative effects of purity testing in political discourse. It is important that individuals engage in a respectful and inclusive discourse, taking into account the diversity of ideas and perspectives. Only then can we hope to foster a healthy and inclusive political discourse.